Hi, and welcome back to Ajua Biotech. Or welcome if this is your first time. Thank you for subscribing and thank you for giving the video a thumbs up whenever it is useful to you. To design your primers, you're going to need your gene sequence. You can get this one from NCBI and you download the FASTA sequence, the FASTA format. Then we're going to need a primer selection software, or we can do it manually, but it's obviously going to be harder on us if we do it manually. So let's use a primer selection software. There are plenty out there. There's Primer3. Primer3 is widely used. It allows customizable parameters and supports various applications and can also handle multiple sequences. The link is in the description. There is IDT PrimerQuest. This one is offered by Integrated DNA Technologies. This tool helps design and order custom primers. It's user-friendly and it has options for probe design as well as integrating it with their ordering service. There's the classic NCBI Primer-BLAST. So this is a tool that combines primer design with a BLAST or a basic local search tool to find specificity against the target genome. And so this tool allows you to ensure that your primers do not bind to unintended regions in the genome. There are softwares, paid for softwares like Genius. These ones are comprehensive bioinformatics software that includes primer design capabilities. This Genius software allows you to visualize sequences and it also integrates multiple analysis tools and offers a user-friendly interface. In that same line of thought, there's also SnapGene. This is a molecular biology software tool that facilitates DNA sequence visualization as well as primer design. It includes cloning simulations and visual representations of genetic constructs. There's also SecMan NGen. This is part of the DNA Star suite. It allows for the design and analysis of primers in the context of genome assembly. It features integration with other DNA Star tools for comprehensive genomic analysis. There's Primer Design. This is a tool for designing specific primers for various applications, including qPCR and sequencing. It features interactive design processes with feedback on specificity and efficiency. And so once you've picked your software, you want to paste the sequence of the gene from which you want to find a primer pair into the designated area. So if we use Primer3 as an example, you paste your sequence in the designated area. Then you make sure that you pick left primer and right primer. Make sure that those options are ticked. Then you want to leave all the other options as is and scroll down to indicate the primer size. You will get the TM and product TM from the manufacturer of your polymerase, because it's the DNA polymerase that you're going to use to amplify your sequence. So whoever you purchased it from, you use their parameters. So one option that you probably want to adjust yourself is the GC, primer GC percentage. So this is the guanine cytosine percentage. It's advisable, as mentioned, that it's between 40 to 60%. So do adjust it if it's starting a bit lower, like the default maybe say 30%. So go ahead and adjust it. You also want to have the option of indicating the product size range that you want the primers to be able to amplify. So if it's like 1,600 base pairs long and you want to be able to amplify say 1,000 base pairs, then you can indicate the range that you want the primer to be selected for. If you ask for a specific product length, say 1,600 base pairs or 1,000 base pairs or even 100 base pairs, it will say that it's an illegal product request. Now, this is because the software wants you to be flexible and designate a range, not a single length. So allow approximately 100 to 150 base pair wiggle room. Once you've adjusted these parameters, you can then pick primers. Click on the pick primers button. So on the primer selected page, you'll be able to view what it recommends as the best primer. So it's got like a start length of the start position for the primer, for the left primer or the forward primer, and then it will give you the position for the reverse or right primer, so you indicate where it's starting from, so you can take a look. And it gives you the melting temperatures again, but you're not interested. And in cases where you probably left it at 30% for the GC percentage, you see that it will still report what the GC percentage content of the primer that it selected is. So in my case, initially I had it at 30%, as the GC 30 to 60%, but the primers that it did produce here, you can see this is okay, even though I hadn't initially restricted it to a minimum of 40%. Okay, so we've got some primers. So what was the magic that went into creating these primers? What makes a good primer? Let's take a look at it. It involves the primer length, the annealing temperature, and the melting temperature. You're going to need to take a look at the makeup of the nucleotides itself in the primer, and you're going to finally look at whether there are secondary structures that can result from these primers. So the software did it all magically for you. You didn't have to take a look just yet using Primer3, but this is what you need to know if you're using other softwares that don't automatically take this into account, or if you're doing it manually. So the primer length that you want needs to be around 18 base pairs minimum to 24 base pairs maximum. If the primer is too short, you will produce less specific products, but if it's too long, you can result in slower hybridization rates for the primer, which means there'll be some issue with creating the product. The annealing and melting temperature needs to be considered. So the annealing temperature is what allows the primer to base pair with the DNA, whereas the melting temperature is where half of the primer will dissociate from the DNA. Here's the rule. The annealing temperature should be below the melting temperature. In other words, the melting temperature should be higher. Your melting temperature should be higher than your annealing temperature. Specifically, you want 5 degrees difference between them. So your melting temperature should be 5 degrees higher than your annealing temperature as a minimum. The makeup of the nucleotides in the primer. So your forward and reverse primers should ideally have similar melting temperatures. There are online tools to help you calculate them. However, there is a way to manually decide what the melting temperature of the primers are. So as a rule, you add 2 degrees for every adenine thymine bonds, nucleotides, but for guanine and cytosines, you're going to add 4 degrees Celsius. Remember, there are more hydrogen bonds. There are 3 in the guanine cytosines connections versus the adenine thymine connections. So you would put 4 degrees for every single guanine cytosine that you have. But if you have an adenine or thymine in your sequence, then each single one gets a 2 degree temperature raise. So then you add it all together to get your final melting temperature for the primer sequence. So as mentioned earlier, I thought I had mentioned even earlier than this, but this is the first instance of it. The second instance, you want to have your GC content, your guanine cytosine content, be 40 to 60%. You want to include guanines and cytosines at the 3' end of the primer. This is referred to as the GC clamp. And so you're going to include 2 to 3 guanines and or cytosines at the 3' end of the primer, if possible. So again, this has to do with how your guanine and cytosine connections have 3 hydrogen bonds. This is one more than your AT pairings. And this ends up helping to ensure that the primer stays tightly on to the intended site for the amplification process. Lastly, you want to check the secondary structures. You don't want these. So depending on the sequence of the primer, you need to be careful that it cannot form secondary structures or dimerize with itself or base pair with the other primer instead of the template. So here you need to use online tools to help warn you if this is a possibility. So you want to avoid hairpins, self-dimers, or cross-dimers. Okay, so you just designed a primer, but you want to take the primer sequences to BLAST, the basic local alignment search tool in NCBI, to check if there are any other sites in the genome where the primer binds. So you want to click on nucleotide BLAST to make sure that you are selecting the right genome to compare to. You need to indicate whether it's human, mouse, insect, parasite, whatever genome you want to search it against, and to make sure that it's not going to bind anywhere else other than to your sequence that you want to amplify. So it may take a bit of time to give you the result, depending on the size of the genome that it has to search against.